Good evening. Well, Chad's gone, so it's a much quieter place now. The hotel feels even quieter without him. We're not even in the same room. Oh, well, it is just a challenge for me to only speak twice and know what to share. I think it helps, too, though, that tonight is the official, unofficial kickoff of your ministry school. How many of you are a part of the supernatural school here? Raise your hand. A few of you. Some of you don't know if you are or not. You're looking around like, am I a part of the school? You are now, yes. So you can get more information about that, I'm sure, but tonight's kind of the kickoff, and so that helps me know a little bit where I'm going to go. I'm going to talk to you. The other night I talked to you as leaders. Tonight I'm going to talk to you as leaders, but also as students, that you are here to learn, to grow, to be stretched. And so we will get into some learning, some growing, and some stretching tonight. So I want to tell you about a couple things. Did you guys get a copy of this yet? Okay, this is yours. Normal Christianity. This was my second book. And it's an interesting one because there's so many books on revival out there. I mean, it is just, I have a shelf of books on revival, and they are, you know, endless. And you can read all the biographies, you can read the histories, you can read all the different things about revival, and it will keep you busy for a long, long time.
Yeah, that's true.
And it's good, but there's a lot of different perspectives on revival. There's whole groups of people that think we'll get revival when we repent enough. And so if we repent enough, then we'll get revival. But then what's the fruit of revival? People repenting. So then you have sort of this cyclical concept that's a little bit confusing. Do you repent first and then you get revival? Or do you have revival and then people repent? And it kind of goes around and around. On the other side, you have you have this issue with, is it getting brighter in here? I feel like I'm getting toasty up here. Maybe we can turn that down before I melt. So we have these different perspectives on revival. And for me, in traveling with Randy Clark, being connected with his ministry for the last 10 years, he's a huge student of revival, passionate about revival. Yeah. Thank you. And one of his things is that, oh, I can see you now. This is great. My pupils are coming back to where they should be. That's trippy. Well, there's so many more of you. Well, his thing about revival, Randy has a really healthy approach to revival that pretty much he can go anywhere and revival will break out, because what he's really teaching is what I present in this book, Normal Christianity. Yeah. That there is no such thing as revival. That's not a word from Scripture. It's a construct that we've come up with. And what we do is we identify when a moment of people living the way that we should be living as kingdom people happens, and we go, oh, it's a revival.
Yeah.
When there's no such thing. I mean, that's like, you know, fairy tales and make-believe that we came up with and said, oh, that's a revival. When in reality, it's just a moment of us coming into alignment of living the way we are supposed to be living our entire life, all the time, anyway. And then we get these weird concepts like, how do you judge what is a revival and what is not a revival? How do you judge that? When in reality, what we call revival, miracles, healing, deliverance, angelic visitations, raising the dead, casting out demons, all that stuff, is just normal Christianity.
Yeah, that's right.
So how do you judge whether it's normal or not? Part of the issue, when you look at the word normal, I use that word I use a comparison, because there's normal Christianity and there's what I call average Christianity. Average is what most of us have in our mindset. It's a rule of measurement. You take however many churches there are in town, you add up that number, and you divide by that number. So you get what you call an average church, and when you ask someone, tell me about your church. Oh, well, we have really good worship. Okay, based on what? Well, compared to all the other churches in town. that's essentially what we're saying, because the rule of thumb that we're operating out of as average is a comparison. You say, well, our church is really good at healing. Based on what? Compared to all the cessationist churches in town. So you end up with a comparison that's constantly going on. That's how you define everything about your church and your Christianity. Well, I'm a better Christian than that person, and that person's backsliding, and that person is in legalism. Well, how do you know they're in legalism? Because I'm a little bit more free than they are. Well, how do you know you're not in legalism? Because I'm not hanging out with any more free people than I am. So you end up with this constant comparison stuff. And so what I've done is I switch. Instead of operating in average Christianity, I challenge us to operate in what I call normal, which is a different system of measurement. Normal is based on there is a norm. There's a normative rule. Let me put it to you this way. When you were born, you have 10 fingers and 10 toes. That is not the average. That is normal. If you're not born with 10 fingers and 10 toes, you're abnormal. I'm not criticizing, but you're considered medically abnormal, not below average. Well, you have 19, digits total, so I guess you're just a little bit below average. No, it's an abnormality. So the difference here is that when you say normal Christianity, the measurement system is based on Jesus. Jesus is the prototype. He is the normal Christian. And as the normal Christian, he's the one we measure against. Instead of saying, I'm really good because I'm better than such and such, and we're doing our averages as a comparison, you look at normal, you say, okay, Jesus is normal. So based on normal, how do we do things? A few years ago, we were almost on the right track with the whole idea of what would Jesus do, except it was limited only to this little area of morality and being nice to people. Rather than, well, what about raising the dead, paying your taxes with fish money, walking on water? It's like we just narrowed it down to one little area, and it's not what would Jesus do. It's like, how would he treat people? Would he be nice to people? Well, duh. It's just kindergarten stuff. Instead of really looking at him as the example. Part of the problem is that we separate ourselves from him as an example by putting him on a pedestal in a way that he would not have wanted. Now, we understand that he is fully God and fully man. He's to be worshipped, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. But there's also something about his life that what we do when we see the miracles, we see the supernatural, so often people write it off as, well, that's Jesus. Right? You go, well, Jesus would have you pray for them and get them healed. Well, that's Jesus. And you go a little further. Well, that was, the early church. That stuff was happening a lot. Well, that's Reading. Well, that's... And everybody puts something on a pedestal to separate themselves from a responsibility.
Right.
It doesn't honor Jesus to be on a pedestal in a way that keeps us from being like him. He's not honored by that. There's nothing for him. He was here to set an example that we could follow, not an example that we could just go, wow, that's so cool, I can be nothing like him. Well, I think it's a good book. So if you're curious about more of that normal stuff and what it really looks like, what I do is I actually take it from multiple different lenses. How did Jesus see women in ministry? How did Jesus see prayer? How did Jesus see raising the dead? It's quite an interesting book in that it goes everywhere. So that would be a fun one for you. Well, turn with me. I want to share a couple other things before we really get into where we're headed. We started at 6, which is great because I have a whole extra hour now.
That's right.
So 1 Corinthians chapter 14, starting in verse 34, women should remain silent in the churches. Oh, okay, I just wanted to start with that. We'll just lay a foundation. They're not allowed to speak, but must be in submission as the law says. If they want to inquire about something, they should ask their own husbands at home, for it is disgraceful for a woman to speak in the church. Don't read those verses. I think this is a verse that's not so popular. Usually not an opening verse for a guest speaker. All right, we'll start with this. Women should remain silent in the churches. Okay, here's what I want to share with you. I want to share with you about women in ministry. I want to share with you about this because this is something that we firmly go after. As a teacher, as someone, a pioneer pushing things forward, I believe this is an area that has been an absolute blight and embarrassment to the body of Christ. What we've taught, what we've believed is absolutely asinine and stupid. And there's just stuff that's being pushed for centuries that's psychotic. And it is not Christian, it is religious. But it's not biblical either. And this is the confusion for us as believers, as kingdom charismatic, woo-woo-woo believers. We believe in the supernatural, we believe in women being empowered. We'll put up a Heidi Baker, a Patricia King, or a Joyce Meyer all day long and honor people for what they're doing. But at the same time, we don't know what to do when we approach these passages. And this is the challenge for me, because as a love, the love that I have for the Word, it requires me to really look at this and go, what does this mean and how am I going to deal with this? I'm not going to ignore it. I'm not going to brush it under the rug. But I'm also not satisfied with the answers I've heard to explain it. One of the big ones is that we've had really weak answers as well over the years. There's been some weak answers about, well, the men sat on one side of the church, the women sat on the other, and so they're trying to tell the women to be quiet because they keep yelling questions over to their husbands. And I don't know, have you ever heard that explanation? Yeah. People have tried to use that explanation. It's really quite pitiful, because then it's still like, well, why is he telling them? It's a disgrace or a shame for them to even speak in the church. Also, you end up with some massive contradictions, because back in chapter 11, only three chapters earlier, he's saying women can prophesy as long as they have a doily on their head. Maybe it doesn't say doily, but you know what I'm talking about. So this concept about women is it would end up seeming very contradictory over in chapter 11. You can speak for God. But in chapter 14, if you open your mouth in church, it's a disgrace. What? Okay, you can speak for God and we'll listen to you, but you can't speak for yourself. That's bizarre. That's confusing. So this has been an area that I've really dug into. And we have a CD teaching on it, but it's also one of our whole chapters in Normal Christianity. And I want to just explain this one. There's three main passages in the New Testament that are used to bring about what we see as the oppression, the suppression, the depression of women in the church. And those three passages, this being one of the harshest, we'll just take this one and we'll take it apart. But I address all three in that chapter and on the CD. So we'll do this one together right now. The first thing that we have to understand is that 1 Corinthians is technically 2 Corinthians. Now, what? Yes, I see heads looking up. What did he just say? 1 Corinthians is technically 2 Corinthians. Now, we did say that this is a ministry school tonight, so you're going to be tracking with some thinking here. We're going to have to really get our thinking caps on. But what I mean by that is this. 1 Corinthians is a response letter. It says in 1 Corinthians 7:1, "Now concerning the things which you wrote to me about, brethren," he's writing back to them. So he's writing back to them. So 1 Corinthians is actually a response from Paul to their letter. "Now concerning the things which you wrote to me about, brethren," and then he begins to respond. And then when you get to 2 Corinthians, it's technically 4 Corinthians, because in between 1 and 2, they've written to Paul again, and then he writes back to them again. Did I lose anyone yet?
Yeah.
Okay, good. It'll be okay. So 1 Corinthians, he's writing back to them. And one of the things that we don't see in our English translations, that you can't see on the surface because there's not like quotation marks here, is that there are quotes from their letter to Paul that he's responding to. There's actually 42 of these quotes in 1 and 2 Corinthians. In the Greek, you can see the quote because there's a little grave accent mark that says, "What I'm about to say to you is quoted from another source." So there's an interaction going on between their writing and his writing that we don't see. It's not evident in our text. Then we have to start looking contextually, going, okay, but if there's a contradiction where for this whole chapter he's saying how women prophesy with doilies on their head, and then you get over here and he says it's a shame for them to even open their mouth and they should just wait till they get home, something funky just happened. There's some problem between here. So here's what's going on. Chapter 11, he says, this is how you do it in your culture. Part of the confusion too, and it's interesting because I get into some really interesting places to speak. And so I get into Presbyterian, Lutheran, Methodist, Mennonite, Plymouth Brethren, Episcopalian. I get into really, really different denominations. And I remember being in one that was Mennonite, that they wanted the Holy Spirit and the gifts, and they wanted to go after everything. And I come in to teach on the spiritual gifts, and they're all wearing their head coverings. And I was like, you guys are ready to prophesy. You got your head coverings and everything. Let's do this. They didn't laugh. But so chapter 11, he does this thing about wearing head coverings. And let me just give you a brief, because I know people get confused. What is he talking about there? It's a cultural context. In the first century, the people who prophesied were the oracles, like the oracles at Delphi. They were temple prostitutes. And the temple prostitutes would have all kinds of makeup and jewelry and braided hair and all this, you know, glamour regalia that they would have. And so what Paul is saying to them in the context of that first century society is, if you wear a head covering when you prophesy, you won't be confused as being like the temple prostitutes that prophesy. Because over in those temples, they would go, you'd hire the temple prostitute, you would do your prostitution, and she would also prophesy to you. It's a combination of sexuality and witchcraft. And so he's saying, inside the church, you don't want to be looking like or being confused with that. So all those little pieces about braided hair, not braided hair, jewelry, makeup, that had to do with their culture and their context. We don't see every single person that has braided hair and jewelry and makeup as a temple prostitute in our culture. Therefore, we don't have to put bonnets on every woman in our church. Totally different issue. So that's chapter 11. Chapter 12, he lays out what the spiritual gifts are. Chapter 13 is the love chapter, how you operate in the spiritual gifts. Chapter 14, how you have them in a public service as a group. You know, let two or three prophesy, let the others judge. You may all prophesy so that you may all be encouraged and all may learn. And he lays out the guidelines of how are you going to do this as a whole church together. You get all the way through chapter 14. You get to this end part, and we'll start in verse 33. For God is not a God of disorder, but of peace, as in all the congregations of the Lord's people. Okay, so that's the one about things being decently and in order. It connects down to verse 40, where he says, but everything should be done in a fitting and orderly way. So Paul is putting the bookends on this little discussion he's about to have with you. And the bookend number one, verse 33, God is a God not of disorder, but of peace. So this is what God's like. He wants order in his house, even when the supernatural is going on. There's going to be an order to it. Then he's going to discuss something. Then in verse 40, but everything should be done in a fitting and orderly way. Now verse 34, where it says women, right before the word women is that grave accent mark in the Greek. The one that says, what I'm about to say to you is a quotation. I am not writing to you this out of my own heart. This is not Paul writing. This is Paul quoting. Mm-hmm. So let me read it to you, and this is the tone of inflection that's written into the language, because there's a quote, and then he responds to it. So, starting in verse 34, "Women should remain silent in the churches. They're not allowed to speak, but must be in submission, as the law says. If they want to inquire about something, they should ask their own husbands at home, for it is a disgrace for a woman to speak in the church." End of quote from their letter to Paul. Did the word of God originate with you? Are you the only people it has reached? If anyone thinks they're a prophet or otherwise gifted by the Spirit, let them acknowledge that what I am writing to you is the Lord's command. If anyone ignores this, they themselves will be ignored. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, be eager to prophesy. Do not forbid speaking in tongues, but everything should be done in a fitting and orderly way. Paul is rebuking them for their quote. He takes their quote and then he tears them apart for it. And Paul has gotten such a horrible reputation for being, you know, anti-women when he is one of the most pro-women individuals in the early church. You start to study through the life of Paul and you look at Romans 16 and all he's doing is saying this amazing woman and this one and this female apostle and this person and this person. He is so pro-women, it's mind-boggling to think that Paul had any issue toward women in ministry. Yeah. But the confusion comes in because when you don't read a verse in context and understand what's going on, it's easy to lift it out and go bizarre directions with it. Mm-hmm. And that's what's happened here. Usually even, you could just read the verse before and the verse after. Even that is going to help you tremendously. There are whole cults that are built on the premise of just what's called proof texting. They already have their cult belief, and then they find the verses and pluck them out to make their system seem scriptural. And if you just say, hey, what about the verse before and after that? Usually their system collapses. It's actually very simple to do with the Jehovah's Witness in particular. You just go, okay, well, let's read the one before it and the one after it. Oh, see how that contradicts everything that you just said? See, that's the issue here is context is so important. And with this women in ministry one, it is a house of cards that collapses very quickly when you start looking at context. Because the Bible actually teaches some of the most pro-liberating equality, gender equality, race equality, economic equality. There's just this tremendous thing that we've so missed because we just read it at face value without any depth of understanding of what was going on. Did that help some of you? Mm-hmm. Well, good. It helps 60% of you, I guess. who needs this?
John, I'll clip that just that part out and put it on your site. Cool. So.
All right.
Thank you.
You're welcome. My wife normally teaches just as much as I do when we travel on the road. We really put it into practice. There's a lot of men who teach on women in ministry, and you never see their wife. Well, that's where it should start. You know, you want to start it at home for sure. Last one, I want to talk about just something interesting about this Raptureless book. As I said the other day, I gave it away for free. So if you want to, you can just go on Raptureless.com and just read it for free. You can just go read it for free. But if you want to actually get a hard copy, we have that. I would appreciate not taking anything home. That would be a tremendous help, and I would appreciate that. But this book in particular is an interesting one because there's so much historical context that we're missing. You know, even just what I was just sharing about the women in ministry thing, we're just missing so much understanding from history of what was going on scripturally. Not that the history isn't there. It's just that we as believers usually don't jump into it. And the people who do usually wear suits and ties and are very hard and boring to listen to. And we're like, you know, I like what he's saying. It's fascinating, but I'm so bored. And so it's important that we, as our stream starts to dig into and get an understanding of history that puts this stuff in context, that we grasp some of what was going on in the first century. Let me give you a for example. In the first century, there's a place called the Agora. The Agora was the public market. It's kind of the farmer's market of the first century. Now, you don't have a giant, you don't have a Trader Joe's, you don't have a Whole Foods, there's no Costco, there's no supermarket of any sort. I know, it's hard to think of a life without a Trader Joe's, but there was a time. And so, at that time, the only place you'd go and get food would be from the other farmers, and you'd trade, and you'd get animals, and you'd get all the stuff you need to get at the Agora. The thing about the Agora, though, was that they had sort of an admittance at the front door where you'd have this giant statue of the Caesar. In particular, Nero had this giant statue set up, and he said, "You cannot go in without worshiping my statue first." So that presents a major problem for first century Christians, because now, how am I going to get food? Am I going to go to the Agora, worship the giant statue of Nero, kind of sell out a little bit, and go in and get food? That presents a major problem, because if you're not going to do that, where are you going to get food then? And they end up really alienated outside of society to a certain degree, where, you know, they're trying to figure out, how do we do this whole food thing without worshiping this giant statue of Caesar Nero? So the first century, there's also this thing going on where Nero, a lot of us don't know the history behind Nero. Nero is one of the most evil individuals. And I know that as a blanket statement, we've heard that, but let me give you a couple, four examples. One, he has his mother executed. Two, he kicks his pregnant wife to death. He lights Rome on fire, burns a third of it to the ground, says it was the Christians who did it, and then releases a 3.5-year, 42-month persecution against the Christians. It's one of the most horrific of history. And then it ends with him at 31 year old stabbing and committing suicide, killing himself. So this is not even an older man. This is someone in my age bracket who's this much of a psychopath, who does all this stuff and then kills himself. So Nero is a bad dude. I mean, like, not just like a blanket statement evil, like, he is evil. And the people of his generation knew that he was evil. And they recorded it. They called him a tyrant. They called him a wild beast. They had all kinds of names for him. One of the most common was they called him a beast. And so Nero has this giant statue set up out in front of the Agora. And you had to go and you had to worship this statue of Nero. Now, what was Nero called? Okay, so you had to worship this giant statue of the beast. And then, before you could go in and get your food, buy, sell, trade, all that stuff, they would take, after you had paid your little amount of money to worship the statue, and then they would sacrifice an animal there, they would take a little bit of the ash off of the altar, and they would put it on you, so that they knew that you had worshipped the beast. And so they would mark your right hand or your forehead with some ash. Does this sound familiar to anybody? I mean, it could just be a little radio chip that we get implanted under our skin, but there also might be that John actually knew what he was talking about. There was something going on that they read it and they went, oh, yeah, we know exactly what he's talking about. The mark of the beast that we have to worship to get into, to buy, sell, or trade. They knew exactly what he was talking about. It wasn't mysterious. It wasn't waiting 2,000 years for technology to be created so that we could finally have that. So, I mean, or, I don't know, maybe the Kirk Cameron movie's right, but I just tend not to think so. Sorry, Mike Siebert. Do you have a copy of this yet? There you go. All right. You ready to really dig in? Let's go to Daniel chapter 2. Daniel chapter 2. What I want to talk to you tonight, I have a few different places I'd like to go. But, you know, one of the things as a charismatic or Pentecostal or whatever you refer to yourself, type of a kingdom person, there's a lot of language that's thrown around. And sometimes we don't understand what that language means. When I say the church, we kind of have a concept of that. When I say the kingdom, we have a concept of that. When I say the bride of Christ, we have a concept. And yet, if I said, could you define for me what the differences are and how they interact? That's where it gets pretty muddy. Can you relate to that muddy feeling? Like, well, there's the church, and there's the kingdom, and there's the new covenant, and there's the bride, and I have no idea how to explain any of those together. You know, when we say church, we kind of have maybe the most clarity. Like, that's the building where we all get together, and once a week, and we sing, and we talk. Well, that's, even that has some conceptual issues with it, because technically, church is ecclesia, it's called out once. So people are the church. We get together in a building, for sure, and maybe our building has certain people that go to it, and so we call them members of that church, but anyone who's a Christian is a member of the church. You see, our language has really caused a lot of, like, I don't know how to communicate this. So then we open up the scripture, and we try to understand certain things, and we don't know what we're talking about. Like, is this the kingdom? Is this the church? Is this the new covenant? Is this the bride? And this is important because what I want to do is I want to lay a groundwork for you, because as a ministry school, as Chad was talking this morning about this being a revival center, these concepts, they have to plug into a foundation. And without the foundation, I mean, I traveled for years with Randy Clark not knowing the difference between the church or the kingdom. So you'd hear this reference all the time, and Bill Johnson talks about the kingdom all the time. But if we think in terms of the church is the kingdom, there's a lot of confusion there. You go, well, that doesn't make sense because my church isn't like that. Or because of this experience, or because I read in scripture this, we don't know where to plug certain things in. So I'm going to lay a foundation for you that you may not have heard before. And we're going to start together in Daniel 2. Let me give you the backstory. Daniel has been taken captive. Babylon has come in. They've taken over Israel, and they took certain people as captives, Daniel being one of them. And Daniel is an advisor, and he's numbered among the sorcerers and the fortune tellers because of his wisdom and his discernment. They put him among that number. Now, King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon has had a dream. And he now is saying, bring in the astrologers and the sorcerers to interpret my dream. And just to add a little more pressure, I'm not going to tell them what my dream is. So they have to tell me my dream, then they have to interpret it, and if they don't do that, they're going to die. I don't know if you ever had a dream interpretation course, but that is some heavy weight right there. Let's see Doug Addison do that.
Yeah.
I love Doug. I just think that's funny. So, in Daniel chapter 2, starting in verse 31, that's where we'll pick up together. Your Majesty looked, and there before you stood a large statue, an enormous, dazzling statue, awesome in appearance. The head of the statue was made of pure gold, its chest and arms of silver, its belly and thighs of bronze, its legs of iron, its feet partly of iron and partly of baked clay. While you were watching, a rock was cut out, but not by human hands. It struck the statue on its feet of iron and clay and smashed them. Then the iron, the clay, the bronze, the silver, and the gold were all broken to pieces and became like chaff on a threshing floor in the summer. The wind swept them away without leaving a trace. But the rock that struck the statue became a huge mountain and filled the whole earth. "This was the dream, and now we will interpret it to the king." So now he's just told him the exact dream. "That's the dream you had, now we'll interpret it. Your Majesty, you are the King of Kings. The God of Heaven has given you dominion and power and might and glory. In your hands he has placed all mankind and the beasts of the field and the birds in the sky. Wherever they live, he has made you ruler over them all. You are the head of gold. After you, another kingdom will arise inferior to yours. Next, a third kingdom, one of bronze, will rule over the whole earth. Finally, there will be a fourth kingdom, strong as iron, for iron breaks and smashes everything. As iron breaks things to pieces, so it will crush and break all the others. Just as you saw the feet and toes were partly of baked clay and partly of iron, so this will be a divided kingdom, yet it will have some of the strength of the iron in it, even as you saw iron mixed with clay. As the toes were partly of iron and partly clay, so this kingdom will be partly strong and partly brittle. Just as you saw the iron mixed with baked clay, so the people will be a mixture and will not remain united any more than iron mixes with clay. In the time of those kings," which if you're following along and you want to underline, that is an important phrase, "in the time of those kings, the God of Heaven will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed. Nor will it be left to another people. It will crush all those kingdoms and bring them to an end. It will itself endure forever. This is the meaning of the vision of the rock cut out of the mountain, but not by human hands. A rock that broke the iron, the bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold to pieces. The great God has shown the king what will take place in the future. The dream is true, and its interpretation is trustworthy." I know that's a longer passage than we typically cover, you know, at one time, but we're just going to start breaking it down together. If you're going to take notes, this is what we have the whiteboard for, and we're just going to go piece by piece, because this is some of the fundamental teaching of the kingdom can really be laid in Daniel chapter 2. We're going to draw a stick figure together, if you'd like to follow. This is my art job right here. My wife has a fine arts degree. I get to do this. Make sure you give him some toes. And we want him to be normal, not abnormal. So we'll give him the right number. These are really more like claws, but we have some interpretation that's given to us very clearly from Daniel himself. We'll make him a happy stick figure. The head is a head of gold, right? That's what he said. "Nebuchadnezzar, you are that head of gold." Now, Nebuchadnezzar is the king over what empire?
Babylon.
That's right. So we're going to put gold on our left here, and we're going to put Babylon on the right. Babylon. Now, after him is going to be another kingdom, and that's going to be the kingdom of silver. After that, a third, and that will be the one of bronze. After that, a fourth, the one of iron. So let's put our lines in. We have the arms of silver, the arms and chest of silver. So we have silver. We have the bronze section here, and we have the legs of iron here. So we have our bronze and iron. You got that so far? Okay. Now in the natural, and this is where it's going to come in, that some of us may have studied this in school, maybe in church at some point, but after Babylon, do you know what the next empire was? Persian, I heard. Persian is correct. It was actually a, what? I'm not looking for the ruler, but what kingdom? It was the Persians. It was the Medo-Persian. It was the Medes and the Persians. If you read through Daniel, you'll actually find that he was operating under three different kingdoms. You have Darius, who's the Mede. You have Cyrus the Persian. You go through and you start to find that he's actually operating under other kings as an advisor. So you have the silver, which is the Medes and the Persians. Now after that you have the bronze. Anyone want to guess on the bronze? The Greeks, that's right. So we have the Greek kingdom. After the Greek, the iron, we have
Rome.
Yeah, we all got that one. Cool. So this, what I've presented so far, nobody disagrees with. There's not any stream of thinking that has a problem with what I've just laid out. The issue comes in because there's much debate over these 10 toes. When you get down past the legs of iron, the Roman Empire, there are some who hack the feet off of this statue and they throw it thousands of years into the future. That teaching takes these 10 toes and says those 10 toes someday in the future will be ruled by Nikolai Carpathia, and that it will be some sort of 10 rulership divided planet, that there will be a king over each section, and that there will be like a UN from hell. That concept comes out of the 10 toes being chopped off and thrown into the future. Part of the issue, though, is what we read in verse 44, in the time of those kings. In the time of those kings, a kingdom was set up. Now, if we believe that we're living in the kingdom, let's just start, ask that question. Do you believe you're living in the kingdom of God right now?
Yes.
Raise your hand, look around, let's see. Okay, quite the majority, and that's wonderful. You're right. And part of the thing is, though, that we believe this because we believe that the kingdom arrived with Jesus. Okay. Not all of our brothers and sisters in the Lord believe that. Not all charismatics believe that.
That's true.
There are large groups and movements of charismatics that don't believe that. They believe that the kingdom is the same thing as the millennium and the end of Revelation, and so we're not in the kingdom, we're in something called the church age, or the age of grace. And because we live in the church age, we don't have to have an expectation of kingdom advancement. We actually can look for the signs of the time, of things getting darker and darker, and go, oh look, it's a sign of the times. Not that I have to rise up and advance the kingdom forward, but that I can just wait because we're so close to the end. That's what happens. There's a tension that people are living in, and it's not a tension. It's a one side is truth and one side is not. There's not a tension here. The concept of what happened is that we've misunderstood the timeline when you get down to these 10 toes. Now, let me explain what happens. You go through this timeline and you get down to the Iron Age of Roman rulership, and there's a man named Augustus. We name our calendar August after him. Augustus Caesar. And Augustus reigned and ruled from 27 BC through 14 AD. Now just think with me for a moment. What important event happened during the rulership of Augustus Caesar?
Jesus.
Christmas! That's when Santa came and died for our sins, right? Maybe I got that story messed up a little bit, but that's when Charlie Brown died for our sins. So Augustus Caesar is reigning and ruling in Rome from 27 BC to 14 AD. Now let me clarify something, because our calendar is a little bit off. And so when we look back, Jesus was not actually born at zero. That's been a confusion for us, because we think zero, then he started his ministry in 30, and then he died in 33. Actually, our calendar being off, he actually was born in 3 BC. That was not his first miracle, we just have our calendar wrong. He was born in 3 BC, started ministry in 27 AD, and then he died in 30 AD. That becomes important later, we'll come back to that. Now, what you have here, in the time of those kings, he will set up a kingdom. In the time of those kings, there will be a rock cut without hands that comes and it crashes into the 10 toes. Here's what's going on with the 10 toes. Have you ever heard of something called the divided Roman Empire? Have you ever heard of something called the revived Roman Empire? not as many have heard of that, or are you just done saying, The concept, we have two concepts here. One is historical and actual and factual. The other is something that we will address in a moment. The concept of a divided Roman Empire. Rome had become so large during this period of time, the iron had grown so large, it crushed and it smashed all other kingdoms to pieces, that it was really hard to keep it together. That's why it began to divide up. That's why some of the kings were referred to as the King of Kings, because what they would do is they would divide up their empire into provinces, and then they would put a king over each province, and they would be able to rule and kind of give a local delegation, like you're the governor of this area. And so they would have their kingdom, their empire, broken up into those pieces. Well, under Augustus Caesar, he broke the Roman Empire from one giant empire. He broke it down into 10 provinces. So that's why it doesn't say in the day of that king, which would have more to do with the undivided empire, but in the day of those kings, plural, referring to it becoming partly of clay and partly of iron. At that point, the Roman Empire had gotten so shaky because people were getting together and doing uprisings. Like you have, it references Simon the Zealot, that there's some of the first century, some of the apostles themselves that had been zealots. Now, a zealot was a rebel, a renegade. They would get together a small group of people and go attack the Roman armies. They were rebel forces. So Jesus has tax collectors, he has fishermen, he has, and he has rebels. These are like guerrilla fighters. And we never really hear much about that, but that's what a zealot is. So he has that kingdom has been divided up into 10 provinces under Augustus Caesar. In the day of those kings, God will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed. Now, we have this rock, and we didn't do anything with our rock yet. We'll have it flying down toward the feet right here. Give it some motion. There you go. This is, now we're in the art class. You got to give it some motion. So you have your rock, and it's flying at the feet. Now, let's think about this. Who was this rock? Could it perhaps be the chief cornerstone that the builders rejected? Could it be the rock that followed them in the wilderness, as Paul calls Jesus? Could it be the stumbling stone that causes offense in Zion, the Romans 11? This rock is a person. And this rock, in the day of those kings, he arrives in the manger in Bethlehem in 3 BC. That's what's going on here. Daniel just interpreted a dream. King Nebuchadnezzar just got an exact timeline for hundreds of years leading up to the arrival of Jesus and the establishment of the kingdom of God on the earth.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's good. Whoa, that's huge. And so what does he do in it? The next chapter, he creates a giant image of gold and says, bow down and worship my giant image of gold or you're going to go in the furnace. Now, he didn't understand what the dream was really about, but Daniel interpreted it correctly. But that, oh, I'm the head of pure gold. I'm going to make a giant statue and make everybody worship me. Unreal what happens with revelation when you don't understand the purpose of it. You end up using it to draw people to you and to gather a following and to gather self-worship rather than that revelation is meant to point you back to Jesus. Kind of an important point. But this is what's going on. So in 3 BC, the rock... Now, here's the significance of this rock thing. It's a rock which connects to earth. It's earthy. It's the humanity of Christ. But it also is cut out of the mountain without human hands, without human intervention. That's the divine side of who Jesus is. So you have both, he is humanity and divinity in this word. That's the rock cut without human hands. So the rock is now hurtling through space and it smashes into the feet, arriving during the ten-toed kingdom in the day of those kings. When Augustus Caesar is ruling in 3 BC, the king arrives in the manger. That's our starting point. Every king has a kingdom. A kingdom is actually a compound word of two different words. It's the king's domain. It's the level of his rulership. If Obama goes to another country, let me say that again, if President Obama goes to another country, I want to be respectful, he does not have rulership over that country. He has a measure of rulership that only extends to our borders and sometimes Puerto Rico. So he has a measure of rulership. Every king does, every president does, every prime minister. There's a measure of rulership, but that's where it stops. So Jesus shows up in the manger as the king. But at that point, he has not exercised dominion, and he's not extended the borders of his kingdom to the entire planet Earth at this point. The king has just arrived in the manger, and there he remains. And so then he begins to grow, he begins to learn, and for 30 years, we don't hear a lot about this king as he's growing up. Well, you get to 30 years old, and he is now being established in his ministry. But the thing about this that we haven't understood culturally is that he's not just going around trying to prove that he's able to heal people and that he has superpowers. Like, that's not the point of his ministry. He has 3.5 years, and in that 3.5 years, the point is to establish what his kingdom is like. If you want to be under King Jesus, this is what being under King Jesus is like. People aren't sick, people aren't dead, people don't have demons, people aren't poor. Under my rulership, that's what it's like living under me as King Jesus. Under that king's domain, people are blessed, people are favored, people are healthy, people are free of their demons, people are alive. Fully alive. Abundant life, perhaps. So you have this situation where what he's actually doing for 3.5 years is demonstrating what his kingdom is like. That's what he's doing. This was not uncommon, where a greater king would come into a place of a lesser kingdom and he would demonstrate bringing all the riches and the goodness of his kingdom, showing that other king how great his kingdom is, to then offer a treaty where they would come into and submit to that king. That was very common. So what they would do is they would write a covenant together. This leads to another piece of our puzzle, because there's confusion where people draw the line and they say, okay, Old Testament ends at the end of Malachi, New Testament begins at Matthew 1:1. Now that's correct, but a lot of us, what we've done is we've said that the New Testament is the New Covenant.
That's good.
The New Covenant did not begin in Matthew 1:1. Actually, you don't hear anything about a new covenant until the Last Supper. So Jesus didn't do a new covenant in his ministry. He demonstrated what being under his rulership is like. And then he called people and invited them into a covenant with him where they could live under his rulership permanently.
Yeah, that's good.
That changes things quite a bit, because people talk about Old Covenant, New Covenant, and they have no idea where to draw the line. And most of us just draw a line right between Old and New Testament. That's not the correct place to draw a line.
That's right.
Then they might jump over and they draw a line between John the Baptist and Jesus. He was the greatest of the old, and now the least in the kingdom is greater than him. That's a good drawing of a line there. But it's still not the full line. Now, I think there's pictures, because actually, let me just say this. We're not going to find a clean line between old and new. Because actually, and I'll demonstrate this as we look at it, actually what you see in the New Testament is a transition from the old into the new. It's not a clean line between old and new. Even the disciples, the apostles, were trying to figure out, do we circumcise people, do we not? Can we have bacon burgers, can we not? I mean, they're like, but he said kill and eat, and it was amazing. So you have all this back and forth going on, and the confusion is that even now the effect of it in the church is that there's many people who lean towards those who were still confused disciples in the first century, who were drawing only out of the old covenant, versus the ones who really understood the new covenant, like Paul and the writer of Hebrews, who walked more in the freedom of the new covenant. So they're working it out in the first century, and there are people still who kind of lean over one side or the other, and it causes some issues in our current Christianity. 2,000 years later, and we still are having issues between old and new covenant. To simplify what I just said, does that make sense? Okay, so he arrives as the king in the manger at Bethlehem. John the Baptist comes and he begins to preach. Repent, the kingdom of God is at hand. The kingdom of God is about to come, it's about to be displayed, it's about to be demonstrated. Jesus begins his ministry with the same message. Then in Matthew 11, I'll just read it to you, I just quoted it a moment ago, Matthew 11, 11. Truly I tell you, among those born of women, there has not risen anyone greater than John the Baptist. Yet whoever is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. From the days of John the Baptist till now, the kingdom of heaven has been subjected to violence, and violent people have been taking it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John. If you are willing to accept it, he is the Elijah who was to come. Whoever has ears, let them hear. It's amazing that he says, and if you are willing to accept it, he was the Elijah who was to come. There are people who still teach that there will be an Elijah to come, a spirit of Elijah movement, a blah, blah, blah Elijah movement, because they are not willing to accept it, and they do not have ears to hear it. John the Baptist fulfilled that prophecy. There is no future Elijah to come movement. That is a confusion that even Jesus knew. If you're willing to accept it, if you have ears to hear it, knowing even for them, the Pharisees of their day were not going to hear it. They were not going to go, yep, John the Baptist fulfilled that prophecy. And we have the same problem 2,000 years later. People still don't see what Jesus said here. Well, part of the issue, though, the law and the prophets prophesied till John. John is the greatest of all who've been ever born of women, but the least in the kingdom is greater than he. That's a verse that I wish was taught a lot more. Because the reality of how often we put Old Testament characters on this pedestal. Like, oh, if I could go up on the mountain like Moses and see his glory. Well, you get to live in his glory and be a carrier of his glory. Yeah, Moses had like a moment, and it still had to be veiled, and it was so much less than what you get to live in. But because we're not taught the height and the majesty of what we've received, we think, looking back, that there's a good old day. And those are not the good old days. You're living in the good old days, and it's going to get a gooder day in the future. Part of the confusion, this glory to glory thing, when we understand that we move from glory to glory, we can understand the truth is this. The church currently has more glory than any church that's ever existed, and tomorrow it will have more glory than it ever has had. The reason being, there's no point where it stops and recedes. It goes from glory to glory. So that means every single day there's more glory to this thing.
Yeah, that's true.
And the confusion has been that we think, well, at some point it stopped, and now we're living in great days of darkness, and it's going downhill. When in reality, the church is still rising and rising and rising and rising. It's been a confused thinking. We are the most glorious church that has ever existed, and that's more true today than it was yesterday. And it will be continually true every single day that we declare that. So when we look back and we think, oh man, to have the Ark of the Covenant, it's got the manna in it, it has the Ten Commandments, it has Aaron's rod that came back to life and put out buds, You have all that awesome stuff in the old covenant. You have two cherubim on the top and a blue flame that hangs over it. The manifest Shekinah presence of God is hanging over this box. It's so easy to kind of do what a lot of Christians do, and we make the Old Testament an idol. Like, oh, if only we had a cloud of fire, a pillar of fire and a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. If only we had that, then people would just be able to see God and know God. And we have these concepts of things that we put on pedestals, but here's the issue. You get to the New Testament, and now you become the temple, which means the ark is inside you.
Yeah.
He didn't put the law on stone tablets inside the ark any longer. Now he wrote those laws on your heart. So you have the laws written on your heart. You have the bread of life, which is Jesus. So you have the manna in you. And you have resurrection, life, and power in you, which is Aaron's rod that came back to life and put out buds.
Yeah, that's
good. So you have all the components of the ark inside you now as the temple and as the carrier of his presence. That's you. And so on the day of Pentecost, a flame lands right over their head and rests there. Just like the flame that used to hang over the ark between the two cherubim. You get the picture?
Yeah.
All that stuff is just a shadow. It's just a shadow, it's just a type, it's a symbol that leads us to the reality in Christ.
Yeah.
So we don't worship the shadow. That's what the Israelites did, where Moses holds up the staff that has the serpent on it, our medical symbol, and people get healed of the tumors. And when the truth of the picture is that Jesus will be put up on a staff and he'll become sin for us so that we can be forgiven and become the righteousness of God, that's the symbol. And later on in Israel's history, they actually are worshiping the staff with the serpent on it. I don't know if you've read through the whole Old Testament, but later they take that same thing that was a picture of Christ, that they then turn that into an idol. And we've done much of the same thing. Now, a clarifying statement that would be helpful is that not all of the Old Testament is Old Covenant. Not all of the New Testament is New Covenant.
Yeah.
And you know it's so much easier just to draw a line between Matthew 1:1 and the end of Malachi. But it causes so much of a mess in our thinking as well. When we look at the Old Testament, you don't have an old covenant until you get to Exodus 32 and Mount Sinai, where Moses goes up and receives the law. So from Genesis 1:1 to Exodus 32, there is no old covenant. And by the time you get to Jeremiah 31 and Ezekiel 36, God is talking about replacing the thing. Like, I'm looking forward to the day when I can take out that heart of stone and put a heart of flesh in you and write my laws on it and put my spirit in you to guide you into all truth. So he's got that. He's declaring it. He says in Jeremiah 31, I will make a new covenant with you. It will be nothing like the old covenant. I love that sentence.
Because
there's a lot of twisted thinking that thinks, well, we're basically old covenant, except we don't kill animals anymore because Jesus took away the sacrifice, but we still have to follow everything else. No, the old covenant is nothing like the new covenant. Hebrews says he set aside the first to establish the second. There's a transition that is absolute. It is huge. It is not a small transition. It is a massive change.
Yeah.
And so this massive change too, the other thing that's important for us to remember, because a lot of people get confused as if God wanted the old covenant. God didn't want an old covenant. God did not want an old covenant.
Yeah.
The old covenant was not his idea.
Yeah.
He didn't want it, and he was glad to get rid of it. Mm-hmm. When you go back to Exodus 32, he says, tell the people to consecrate themselves for 3 days and then come up on the mountain to meet with me. He wants direct relational interaction with the people. And the people say, no, no, no. Because of the fire and the mountain, it's all so scary to us. just send Mo up there and have him be the mediator. Mo the mediator is going to come back and have him tell us what it is that we're to do and we'll obey. They call for an old covenant. God, give us a rule book and we'll just do that. We don't want direct relationship. It's scary. So just send Moses to give us the rule book and we'll obey. And he says, okay, here's how it's going to go down. Here's the rules. If you do this, you'll be blessed. You do this, you'll be cursed. And that's how this will all play out. And you get to play that out for 1,500 years, and then you'll realize how awful rules and this rule book and this concept, and then we can change it. See, the old covenant was never God's idea, never wanted it, and wouldn't have even had it if it weren't for their fear of relationship. So now he finally comes. The king is here, and then he starts to demonstrate his kingdom for 3.5 years. He declares the kingdom of God is now at hand, and he demonstrates what being under his rulership is like, healing and miracles and raising the dead and all of that. And he demonstrates it. But at the end of his ministry, now he's going to cut a covenant. This is the blood of my covenant. That's the Last Supper. And then the following day, he establishes his covenant. Okay, so here's what's going on. After a king had come and he had demonstrated what being under his rulership is like, he would then offer a covenant. You'll be my people and I'll be your king. And this is what it will be like. Now, the new covenant, as we see from Scripture, is very clearly laid out in Hebrews chapter 8. Hebrews chapter 8 is really a quote from Jeremiah 31, where he's saying, I will forgive their sins and remember their evil deeds no more. And he goes into greater detail, and we're not going to go there right this second, but he ministers for 3.5 years, demonstrating what it's like. Then at the Last Supper, he declares he's going to make a new covenant. Now, to make a covenant, you had to have a blood sacrifice. So Jesus, wanting to set up a new covenant, makes a blood sacrifice of himself. The interesting thing about this is that we have a lot of really bad teaching in the prophetic charismatic circles regarding covenant. People think that America has a covenant with God. Maybe you've heard that. You don't have to raise your hand. But people think that America has a covenant with God. People in this room may even think that they have a covenant with God. What? Where are you going with this one, Jonathan? Just hang on a minute. It'll be okay. So the confusion is this. The only covenant that exists is between Jesus and the Father. Under the old, it was God and Israel. That was the old. God and Israel. You obey, you'll be blessed. You disobey, you'll be cursed. That's the covenant. That's the terms of this covenant. Now, part of the issue is that they could never keep up their end of the deal. So they're constantly living under curses. So they're failing over and over and over. And since they could never keep up their end of the deal, God devises a new plan. Here's what I'll do. I'll put on human flesh, and I'll stand on the human side, and God the Father will stand on the God side. And Jesus comes down, and he represents mankind to cut the covenant. So now Jesus is the high priest, who's the one who represents the people to God. So Jesus, as the high priest, goes in to cut a covenant with God, but he also is both the representative as the priest. He's also the blood sacrifice. So as the perfect sinless man, he also is the perfect sinless lamb. And the high priest, Jesus, puts his own blood on the mercy seat in heaven. The covenant that exists now is between God the Father and Jesus the Son as a representative of mankind. So the covenant that exists that we get the benefit of, you get perfect covenant with God because you get to step inside Christ.
Yeah.
The covenant, the only covenant that exists is between Jesus and the Father. you don't have a covenant with God. You get to live inside the perfect covenant with God. There's nowhere in the New Testament that talks about us as individuals having a covenant with God. Jesus established it as the high priest representing humanity to God and as the perfect lamb sacrifice to cleanse the way between that covenant. So the covenant is between God the Father and Jesus the Son. So you have also a problem here because the confusion about, well, but America has broken covenant with God. America doesn't have a covenant with God. America might be, you know, disobedient and doing a bunch of evil stuff, but it's not breaking any covenant. That's not a true teaching. Part of the issue with that comes in is this concept of sheep nations and goat nations. You ever hear that one?
Yeah.
I've heard for years about, you know, we want to be a sheep nation, not a goat nation. And it comes out of Matthew chapter 25, where he says, I'll gather all the nations before me, and then I will divide the people one from another as sheep and goats. It doesn't say I will divide the nations one from another as sheep and goats. I will divide the people one from another as sheep and goats. So if he takes the 140 nations, or however many there are now, 250, or I have no idea, but you take all the nations in the world, you put them together before God, and then he divides the people as individuals, one from another, as sheep and goats. But when you get into the sheep and nations, sheep and goat nations teaching, and you start to wonder, is America a sheep or is it a goat? And then you start to get over into this thing of, like, how do you become a sheep nation? Well, is 51% of your nation being Christian make it a sheep nation? I just wonder, I mean, you get down, I think... I use one of these things, it's called the magnifying glass, where you take something and you take that theology, that piece of thinking, and you magnify it times 100. Where does it end up? See, if we believe in the love of God, we believe in the love of God times 100. We believe in freedom and truth and love and joy. Those times 100 are still solid. But when you start talking about sheep and goat nations and you start extrapolating where that goes, I think the best idea is we got passports for every country. And every time it dropped below 51% Christian, we should move. Because otherwise, when we're standing there and we go, I'm an American. He's like, oh, it was only 49% Christian. Goat nation. And you're over in the pit fire now. People aren't thinking the implications of these crazy teachings. And so, oh, we got to make our nation a sheep nation. No, just make everybody a sheep. Like, if you get everybody in the nation to be a sheep, then, you know, the whole nation can be a sheep. But it's not about going and putting all just the right type of Christian in charge so that then they can enforce all the rules from top down, and then we'll finally be a sheep nation. There's a problem with some of that thinking. One, it's ultra-controlling. When in reality, we should be able to change laws because nobody would want to do that kind of evil because everybody in our country became a sheep. Hello?
Yeah.
I know it's an election year. You're not sure what to think of what I'm saying. That's okay.
Well, I don't know if I can agree.
But the reality is Jesus focused on people. He didn't focus on coming in and trying to change the political system. He focused on changing it by changing all the individuals. What's amazing is that I think that Paul was actually trying to get to Nero. This is amazing. Paul, every time, he keeps using his Roman citizenship to try to go to a higher level of government. I think that if he had been able to keep going without Nero having his head cut off, without cutting Paul's head off, he probably at one point would have been able to stand before Nero and share the gospel with him. I think that that was Paul's target the whole time. Like, take me to the next guy. Take me up a little further. You know, I appeal higher. And he keeps going further, getting closer and closer to this beast. Talk about that would have changed the course of so much history. So, these concepts about covenant really, one of the big issues that really explains it is only the greater can make a covenant with the lesser. A king that is greater than a lesser king is the one that can come and offer covenant. A lesser king can never offer covenant to a greater king. I'll make covenant with you. I don't want any of your piddly little stuff. It's always the greater that offers a covenant to the lesser. That's why no nation on earth, you can get every king and every president, every senator, every congressman together, and they all say, today we strike a covenant with God. And it means nothing in the spirit realm to God. Because to God, he only has a covenant with his son, and only the greater can offer covenant to the lesser. And the only covenant God wants is with his son, because his son did a perfect job. And he could give a covenant to all those presidents and senators and whatever, and the next thing you know, and a generation goes by and we fall away and we're just in the same boat as the old covenant again. We're trying to uphold our end of the bargain. We need to cut that out and just step inside the perfect covenant and receive all its benefits. The only way for you to break covenant now is by stepping outside of Christ. And in that sense, you're just leaving all the benefits. There's no reason to do that, ever. But that's what people do. They just step outside. That's the only concept of breaking covenant now, is stepping outside of Christ and receiving perfect benefit from his covenant with the Father. A little stretching for some of us? That's okay. You guys are getting it. It's good. So, he offers a covenant. This is the blood of my new covenant. The next day he inaugurates it. He establishes it by his death. It is finished. What is finished? The typology of the shadows from the Old Testament, Jesus walked them out and established it. You look at the life of Jesus and what he's doing, it's fascinating when you start to line it up with the shadows. And then you go back to the Old Testament, you have a man named Jacob who has a son named Joseph. Joseph has a bunch of dreams, ends up in Egypt, and then God talks about, out of Egypt I've called my son. He leads Israel out of Egypt, takes them across the body of water. Now, I just say that, you'll see why in a moment, but he leads them across the body of water, and then they wander in the wilderness for 40 years. That's the story, we all know it, it's kind of the old school version. Jesus walks out that shadow. Jesus is born, but his father's name is Joseph, right? I mean, technically we're saying stepfather, but his father's name is Joseph. So Joseph, his father's name, and you'll see this when you study out the beginning of the story, Joseph's father's name is Jacob, beginning of the New Testament. So there's a Jacob who has a Joseph. Then this Joseph has some dreams, like the other one did, and he ends up taking Jesus away from Herod to protect him into Egypt. Then while they're in Egypt, after 2 years, he has another dream, and they bring him out of Egypt, and the same verse is quoted out of Hosea that says, out of Egypt I have called my son. These are the same verses from the Old Testament. Calls him out. Then we see Jesus, you got this long pause button, and after 30 years, now, Jesus shows up again, and he is baptized. The picture of Israel going through the water in the Old Testament was a picture of baptism. Jesus gets baptized. Why? To repent of all his sins? No. There's no value in Jesus getting baptized and anything to do with sin. It has to do with fulfilling the shadows perfectly and in order. So that's why he says to John, John's like, you should be baptizing me. And he's like, yeah, no joke, but... Maybe that's the message version. He says to him, John, I have to do this to fulfill all righteousness. He's fulfilling the shadows perfectly. And he's like, I know, John, but I got to do this because that's the next thing on the story. This is the timeline. I'm walking it out. Like, you know, it's not, I know I didn't sin, but that's what he does. So he gets baptized. Then what does he do? Instead of 40 years in the wilderness, he spends 40 days in the wilderness. And his 40 days in the wilderness, he fights the devil, quoting three times from Deuteronomy, the book that was written while they wandered for 40 years. He actually walks out this whole thing. This is Jesus walking it out, fulfilling all this stuff. So by the time you get to, it is finished, now you know what he's talking about. I got it done. I did everything. I did the whole types. I did all the symbols. The old covenant is finished. All that stuff is over. My sacrifice of death makes all the sacrifices of animals obsolete and outdated. And now things are moving forward.
Hallelujah.
Amazing. So he dies. He dies and it deals with our sin. But, you know, there's a few things where a lot of us don't understand the difference of importance between his death and his resurrection. We also don't understand his death and the nature of it. Let me just clarify. I love this. I love studying this kind of stuff out. And one of the things I found is that Jesus could have just had his throat slit and the whole world would have been forgiven. We have thought that this whole thing is all one package deal, but there's more going on here. If the type and shadow is an animal sacrifice, the perfect lambs of the Old Testament would have their throat slit and it would cover the sins of man. Right? We understand that. No sheep in the Old Testament was beaten to death. You understand that, right? They didn't pull the sheep's beard out. They didn't mock it, spit on it, whip it to death. They didn't do that. They just cut its throat and people were forgiven. It's the shedding of blood that provides forgiveness of sin. So why did he go through hell? He went through what he went through to get us the total package deal. Now let's back it up for a second. If he had got his throat slit, his blood would have forgiven all mankind. You would have been forgiven, but you still could have been sick. You still could have been sick, you still could have been poor, you still could have been living under shame, condemnation, guilt. You could have lived under all that stuff. So what does he do? By his stripes, he bought you healing. He bore shame so that you don't have to carry shame anymore. He died on a tree, carrying anyone who dies on a tree is accursed, taking all our curses so you have no curses anymore. Every piece of this is him replacing something to get you the total package deal. He could have just got us forgiven, but it wouldn't have gotten us all the other stuff that we needed to get back to Eden. We would have been forgiven in the eyes of God, but we would not have been back in Eden. But now we live under no curse. We live under there's perfect healing, perfect curse-free life. There's no shame. These are the things that he bought for us with all the extra. So then, here's another challenging thought. If Jesus wasn't raised from the dead, you still would have been forgiven. That's true. How many lambs in the Old Testament got raised from the dead? It just didn't happen. Something else is going on here. In the picture we have, what we understand is that he died to deal with who you were. He was resurrected to make you something completely new and different. His death provides mercy and forgiveness. His resurrection provides grace and a new creation.
Amen.
In his death, you're united with him in his death, but his resurrection, you're united with him in his life.
Yes. Yeah.
This is the other side of the coin. The grace was not released until the grace of a new creation comes out of the grave, and he's the first fruit of a new creation. Mm-hmm. Then now after him, he started something new. Let me give it to you in another picture. You are God's inheritance, but there's also an inheritance that's been given to you. So let's say, I'll put it this way. Jesus writes out his will. I want him to be healed, delivered, free, forgiven, shame-free, curse-free. He writes out his will. Now, a will does not get enacted unless someone dies. So he has to die to establish his giving of that inheritance to us. But then he also gets resurrected, which is him coming back as the executor of his own estate to make sure you got everything. So I write the will, then I make sure I die so you get it, and then I come back to go, did you get everything? See, most people, when they get resurrected, they go, can I have my stuff back? I'm going to need those clothes and that house and that car like I'm still alive. He comes back just to go, did you get it? Did you get everything that I gave you in the inheritance package? Selah. He comes back, and at the beginning of Acts chapter 1, he still cannot stop talking about his kingdom. He's got 40 days that he talks to them, then he disappears for 10 in between Pentecost and the last of those 40 days on earth. But the 40 days that he's here, he continued to teach them and instruct them regarding the kingdom. The kingdom is so much of Jesus' focus, it is just unreal. It's like the thing that he's focused on. The kingdom, the kingdom, the kingdom. Let me give you another parable. Let me demonstrate it. Let me show it to you. This is what it's like. To not think that we're in the kingdom is to really just take the book of Matthew and just rip it out of your Bible and chuck it away. Like, you don't need all the kingdom teaching if we're not in the kingdom. If the kingdom is the millennium, so after we get raptured and 7 years of hell on earth and blah, 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 and all that happens, and then the kingdom shows up with the millennium, then anything about the kingdom in the New Testament is of zero value to us. And then we end up saying things like, we're part of the church age. I don't know if you ever have really looked at what that means, but when people say church age rather than the kingdom, what they're really saying, it's a teaching, it comes out of this thing called dispensationalism. And it's this concept that says that Jesus came to Israel, Israel and the Jews rejected him, so he took the kingdom back. So all the teaching we have in Matthew about the kingdom, that was for the Jews. They rejected it, so Jesus took it back into heaven with him. And he's like, okay, I talked about the kingdom, but you didn't want it, so I get to keep it. But you know what, Jews? To make you envious, what I'll do is, for the next 2,000 years, we'll have what we call the church age, and I'll get a bunch of Gentiles saved to make you envious. Then I'll come back, and I'll pull the church out of here, and then I'll bring the kingdom to my Jewish people. And so the church ends up being plan B, according to this theology. And according to this theology, God never even anticipated plan B, so there's no teaching about the church in the whole Old Testament. This is what some theologians, I know you're looking at me like, well, that's really stupid. Yes, but theologians believe this and teach this. And it is taught in a lot of American seminaries, and pastors have heard this for decades. And the confusion comes in because we go, well, are we a part of the church age, or are we a part of the kingdom? Are we in the kingdom, or are we in the church? See, part of the issue is that there's confusion over when the church started. The church didn't start in the New Testament. The church started in the Old Testament because the word ecclesia, called out ones, was used all through the Old Testament. Have you ever heard of what's called remnant theology? People talk about a remnant bride, a remnant this, a remnant that. Basically, they're saying there's like a good part of the church and then the rest of those. And, you know, there's the good church, which are the people who believe what I believe because I'm right. And then there's everybody else.
Yeah.
The remnant teaching causes a problem because it was true in the Old Testament there is a remnant. You have the whole earth is about to be judged. So he takes Noah and eight people and puts them on the ark. They're the remnant. Then you have Gideon, and he has his 300, and they go to war with the Midianites. It's a remnant picture. You get to Elijah versus the prophets of Baal, and he says, am I the only one left? Is his despairing cry to God, and God says, no, there's a remnant, 7,000 that have not bowed their knee to Baal. In the Old Testament, the Old Covenant, there was always a small group of people who got it right and walked with God. But then there was a general population, which Ezekiel and Jeremiah and these other prophets just tear apart. Passages that we don't read in church. We're like, you know, if you're under 13, cover your ears. They're so, like, you know, and just the things that they talk about. Ezekiel 16 and Ezekiel 23 and just these chapters where he's like, Israel is a whore. and he nails them for the whole nation, but there's always a pocket, a remnant that's not. That's the ecclesia, the same word for church in the New Testament. The church has always existed. Under the old covenant, though, because the church is trying to exist under a system where we're trying to live up to standards so that we can be blessed and not cursed, only a few people were able to do it. But when he establishes a new covenant of grace with us, there's no remnant in the New Testament. Because as we read in Daniel 2, he talks about this mountain, that this mountain comes in as a rock cut without hands, and it crashes into the toes, crushing them, and then it grows into a mountain, and then a mountain that fills the whole earth. There's no remnant in the New Testament. There's no remnant in the New Covenant. There's the word remnant is used several times in Romans 9, 10, and 11, where Paul is talking about a select amount of the Jews of his day that are turning to the Lord. He's not talking about the church being a remnant. Jesus turns to his disciples and he calls them little flock. Because at that time, they were a little flock. They were the rock cut without hands, but they were growing. We're no longer a little flock. There's 2 billion of us. That's a third of the planet's population. You said earlier, and it's very true, that we've overtaken the birth rate. There are more people being born again than are being born nowadays. But actually, the birth rate is 2%. The born again rate is 8%. Yeah. There are 4 times as many people being born again as are being born.
Yeah.
Based on a straight line projection, if that number continues, and statistics are a fool's game, they say, and so you can't really just take this at face value, but if you were to take that number and run it forward, by 2033, everybody on the planet would be a Christian. And yet people still think we're not doing so well.
Crazy.
Maybe you need to turn off some Christian television. But he describes the nature of this kingdom. In Matthew 13, he says, the kingdom of God is like a little bit of leaven that's worked through 60 pounds of flour, and it works its way through the whole batch of flour. He says, the kingdom of God is like the little mustard seed that grows into a bush, and then the bush turns into a tree, which is like an agricultural miracle. It turns into a tree, and then it becomes the greatest tree in the garden, and all the birds of the air can come and rest and nest in it. Amazing. That's the nature of the kingdom. Part of the issue of this other teaching has been that the kingdom is the millennium. It will show up as if a skyscraper just drops out of heaven one day, all at once. The kingdom is not all at once. The kingdom is a slow, progressive momentum that is taking ground and moving forward day by day by day by day. From a little mustard seed to a bush to a tree to the biggest tree. From a rock to a mountain to the biggest mountain that fills the whole earth. From a little bit of leaven worked through 60 pounds and it goes through the whole batch of dough. That's the nature of the kingdom of God. And the kingdom of God started back here in 3 BC when the king arrived. Then at 27 AD, he begins to demonstrate his kingdom for 3.5 years. After 3.5 years, he announces to them, now I will offer you a covenant. The greater is offering a covenant to the lesser. Here's what the covenant is. It's a covenant in my own blood. And then he establishes it the following day with the shedding of his blood. He comes back to check. Did you get everything that you inherited? It is finished. The old is finished. Here's the new. The new is here. You're a new creation. And he establishes the new and puts it in place. And all the extra stuff he got was to buy us the whole total package deal. The healing and the curse-free life and the shame-free life and the everything else that he purchased for us. So we get into this new covenant, and that's where we live. We live in the kingdom. There is no remnant theology that is true nowadays, because we're not a remnant. we're an overcoming, taking force, taking ground. We occupy till he comes. The increase of his government and peace is without end, Isaiah 9. So this thing is just continuing forward as we continue to establish. There was a book of common prayer that was found from about 200 AD. So we're talking early church. A book of common prayer. Now, we don't usually use that. We do our own, you know, woo kind of prayer the way that we do it. But other denominations, they have these books, and this is what you pray on specific days. Well, they had a book of common prayer in 200 AD, and this book of prayer had a calendar system built into it. So you know what to pray every day into the future. The calendar system of this book was set up. So in 200 AD, they write this book of common prayer, and they go, we need to establish a calendar system in it. How long should it be? It goes to 8,400 A.D. Maybe they were not living on the edge of their seat, thinking any second could be the rapture. They would build churches that take 100 years just to finish building the church. And most churches now, you know, it's like, okay, we're just going to move in here because we don't want to establish something long term in this area, because if we do that, you know, we're wasting our time and our funds. We need to send all of our funds to do this or do that. When in reality, look, we're going to be here a while. We're not done. It's going to be a glorious, spotless bride without spot or wrinkle, right?
Yeah.
We agree. We're like, yeah. Are we anywhere near that right now?
Not so much.
He says the apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher are here until. He says they're for the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry until.
Yeah.
As a time qualifier, until we reach the unity of the faith. There's currently 33,000 plus Christian Protestant denominations. We're not going to get to a point of having a one world denomination, and then we'll have the unity of the faith. But we're definitely not at the unity of the faith yet. And we need those fivefold ministers to equip and train and build the body long term, because we have something ahead of us that we're not near yet. We have a lot more to establish. There's a day where it talks about the groaning of the earth. The groaning of the earth is waiting for its liberation into the freedom of the glorious sons of God. The glorious freedom of the sons of God, which means there's a qualifier. Before the earth can stop groaning, this is Romans 8, before the earth can stop groaning and come into freedom, it's going to come into the glorious freedom of the sons of God. That means we have to be walking in what would be called glorious freedom for the earth itself to receive from us that glorious freedom. There's a lot more glorious freedom for us to step into, for us to start really in affecting even planet Earth.
Yeah.
I just want to challenge the, like, any second kind of thinking that keeps us from actually doing something.
Yeah.
I mean, why would I keep writing? Why would I keep traveling and teaching and all that if I didn't have a focus for long term? We got to build. We got to do things. We got to establish. We got to lay foundation. I'm going to have great grandchildren that a righteous man leaves an inheritance for his great grandchildren.
Yeah. Yeah.
For his children's children. So there's something about a righteous man does that. An unrighteous man doesn't do that. Mm. He can't even bring the food to his mouth, it says of the lazy man. Just kind of, whatever. I'm not going to go out because a lion roars in the street. I love that proverb. Like, yeah, I could. If I go out and work, I could get killed. there's something about the way that we've approached this that causes passivity. I get the question all the time, why is it that other countries have all this big revival and we don't? And we get things like, well, because we have hospitals, and we have this, and we have, you know, we're not praying enough, and we're not fasting enough, and we're not blah, blah, blah. And the reality comes down to the number one thing that Jesus warned against, and the apostles warned against, was false teaching and false doctrine.
Yeah.
that chokes the life out of the Western church, is our false, evil theologies that have been taught to us, that whether it's cessationism or dispensationalism or, you know, God is just some big control freak in the sky, these teachings cause complete passivity. If God wants to move, he'll move. What am I to do about it? I'll just sit back and wait. And if he's going to move, it's because I manipulate him. I twist his arm hard enough. If you don't show up, I'm going to die because I fasted too long. We're trying to like manipulate a father who wants to be with us more than we want to be with him.
Yeah.
As if the equation is wrong on his side, not our side. But it's such a warped thinking that, well, why is it that we don't have revival? Most of it is because we got poison in our water hole.
True.
Nobody wants to come drink from our well. Because we just dumped a bunch of arsenic in there, and we're like, hey, all you who thirst, come and drink, and you'll be thirsty again every single day of your life, wondering, why am I drinking this water? But if we can get the water clean, it'll be like Simon the Sorcerer. I'll give money for what you have, Peter. That's the fish are jumping in the boat. You're not even casting the line anymore, and the fish is like, whoop. That's kingdom living, that people are like, I want what you have.
Yeah.
Even the governor's saying to Paul, you know, you've almost persuaded me to be a Christian in one message. A pagan leader who's being worshipped as God in his region is like, wow, I want, this sounds amazing. Not, oh, another Christian. What do you want me to outlaw? That's not Paul's approach, right? Hello?
Yeah.
But this is our confusion, because we've thought in terms of the church, and we've thought in terms of a victim mentality as a little remnant just trying to survive. And we've thought the kingdom's not here, it's going to come in the future, and it'll drop out of the sky all in one moment. Boom. When in reality, you're an ambassador, a citizen of heaven, a son or a daughter of God. You're establishing the kingdom of the king. He's the king of kings, not the king of slaves.
Come on.
He is not the king of orphans. He is the king of kings. That's you and that's me. You're a king, so he's king over kings. He's not the king of orphans. He's not the king of slaves. He's not the king of victims. But he's the king of kings. You feel the weight of that? That's just healthy. That is health right there.
No, that's grown-up talk.
That's grown-up talk. Chad would be so proud, Steve.
Yeah. Good student.
I want to land this, but let's go over to Hebrews chapter 8. So that we can land it together instead of jumping out with parachutes. Hebrews chapter 8, we'll kind of skim through it here. We'll start in verse 6. But in fact, the ministry Jesus has received is as superior to theirs as the covenant of which he is mediator is superior to the old one. Since the new covenant is established on better promises. For if there had been nothing wrong with the first covenant, no place would have been sought for another. But God found fault with the people and said, "The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I'll make a new covenant with the people of Israel and with the people of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand and led them out of Egypt. For they did not remain faithful to my covenant, and I turned away from them, declares the Lord. This is the covenant I will establish with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my laws in their minds and write them on their hearts. I will be their God. They will be my people. No longer will they teach their neighbor or say to one another, know the Lord, because they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest. For I will forgive their wickedness and will remember their sins no more." Here's the verse we're going to focus in on. By calling this covenant new, he has made the first one obsolete, and what is obsolete and outdated will soon disappear. Now, most people, when they take this verse, what they focus in on is that the old covenant has become obsolete and outdated. True, wonderful, glorious, happy part of the verse. There's also another part that's amazing, but rarely taught. And it's the last part of verse 13. What is obsolete and outdated will soon disappear. I don't know if the implication is registered with you yet, but that means it still was there. A lot of us have taken the thought that when Jesus died on the cross, that it is finished, and now there's a new, that if we move the line from Matthew 1:1 being the beginning of the new covenant to the death and resurrection being the beginning of the new covenant, that's true. That is the beginning over there. But that also doesn't mean that the old was gone yet. It means that it was obsolete and outdated. It had become obsolete and outdated, but it still was there. The priests continued to offer sacrifice year after year in the temple in Jerusalem. They continued killing animals and disacknowledging what Jesus had done on the cross. Now that smoke is going up to the nostrils of God. For 40 years after 30 AD, it just keeps going up year after year as people continue to kill animals. And now, instead of it actually being something that appeases God with the forgiveness under the old covenant, now it's like this stench in the nostrils of God that points to the fact that they will not acknowledge the perfect sacrifice of his son. There was a thing on the chest plate of the high priest in the Old Covenant in the Old Testament called the ephod. And inside the ephod, you had a black stone and a white stone, and those were called the Urim and the Thummim. When they would do this each year, they would reach inside and they would pull one out. And if it was a white stone, it meant that God had favor on them for that nation. It's kind of like Groundhog's Day. And if they pulled out the black stone, it meant that they were cursed under God for that year. For hundreds of years leading up to the death of Jesus, white stone, favor, 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 white stone, white stone, white stone. 30 AD till 70 AD, black stone, black stone, black stone, every single year, leading up to the destruction and annihilation of Jerusalem in 70 AD. There was a transition that took place because they were no longer living under the favor at that point. In Luke chapter 4, which actually Chad referred to this morning, where Luke chapter 4, though, is where Jesus gets up and he declares, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me too," and he gives his whole job description. It's a quote directly out of Isaiah 61, except there's two things at play here. One, Jesus takes the scroll and he turns to this passage and quotes it. Well, you weren't supposed to do that. You were supposed to read the scroll where they handed it to you. Here's the scroll, read this. So one, him turning to something, he's already messing with their traditions. Two, he reads it, but he doesn't finish. He stops mid-sentence, hands the scroll back, and sits down. And they're like, what is he doing? He says, "And the year of the favor of our Lord," and he goes and sits down. Instead of finishing it, which the rest of the sentence in Isaiah 61, "and the days of the vengeance of our God." He doesn't declare that. Because he's saying, I'm here to fulfill this first part up to here, but then he stops. The days of the vengeance of our God is later. Actually, over in Luke 21, 22, he's talking about the complete destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD. And he says, and this is to fulfill all that was written, "and the days of the vengeance of our God." So he finishes his prophecy from Luke 4 in Luke 21, 22. And he finally finishes the passage, declaring the days of the vengeance are now coming. And that's what he's declaring is about to come on them in the future. Part of the issue was that the obsolete and outdated will soon disappear. The old covenant lived alongside the new covenant through the New Testament early church. In the New Testament early church, these two are walking side by side. Jesus just established a new, which makes the old obsolete and outdated, of no longer of value. And they're still walking side by side. The king has come, the kingdom's been established, the new covenant's been established, but the old covenant is lingering to its death. It wasn't killed in a moment, it lingers and stumbles to its death. This is a picture that we see throughout the Old Testament as well. In the Old Testament, you have 40 years where they wander in the wilderness while the older generation that believed the spies with the bad report did not have faith and were slave-minded had to die off before the younger generation could rise up and move in fully into the promised land. From 30 AD, when Jesus has now died and been resurrected in 30 AD, not 33, but in 30 AD, from there until 70 AD, there's a 40-year window of time, and I call it a transition generation that was similar to Israel, the older dying off and the new rising up.
Yeah.
King Saul was king for 40 years, but King David was anointed long before King Saul died. King David, representing the new covenant, he's anointed as a little sheep herder. And so then he begins to walk this thing out. He goes from being a shepherd to being a lion killer, a bear killer, a giant killer, to being chased around for, you know, a dozen years by King Saul. Then he gets anointed at Hebron, and then he finally takes over the kingdom. All that time, King Saul, who was anointed at first and almost immediately lost all the anointing that was on his life and was removed from him, that position with God was removed from him, he continued to coast for 40 years as the new was rising up, which is David.
Mm-hmm.
Same picture with the wilderness, same picture with the New Testament. Part of the issue that's going on, Jesus so clearly lays out in Matthew 24 the destruction of Jerusalem that's about to happen in 70 AD. He says all these things will take place within a generation, within 40 years. All of this is about to take place. So when you see that that's about to take place, you have this transition going on where everybody in the early church understood Jerusalem's about to be destroyed. That's why they meet from house to house. Why set up a giant church establishment when you know the city's about to be destroyed? Why are they selling their property? Because they're smart real estate Jews. A whole city's going to get burned to the ground within a generation. Let's sell our property. Brilliant. Jesus tells him in Matthew 24 to flee the city when you see the abomination of desolation. And he explains in Luke 21, the abomination is the armies surrounding Jerusalem which cause desolation. That's in Luke 21. When you see the armies surrounding Jerusalem to cause desolation, flee to the mountains. Well, the whole early church did. They got up and they left. And when Titus, the Roman general, approaches Jerusalem in 70 AD to bring destruction, to kill 1.1 million Jews, to destroy the city to the ground except for the western wailing wall and three towers, to destroy the temple, leaving not one stone on top of another, to kill every priest in the whole priesthood and wipe out the whole system, when that happens, Josephus, the first century historian, records it saying, The Christians remembered the words of their Lord about the coming destruction, and not a single Christian died in the destruction of Jerusalem because they fled the city and lived on the mountain of Pella nearby. He says, when you see it, don't flee back into the city. Well, think about it. Giant army coming at you, or big city behind you with fortress walls. Where do you want to go? Into the city. He says, don't go back in, don't go down to get your coat, don't go anywhere but those mountains. Flee to the mountains. So you run for your life. So you have a transition going on where for 40 years the church is declaring, like Noah, as in the days of Noah, rain is coming. This whole city's going down. This ship is going to be your only rescue, is to flee with us. You need to come and join us on the ark. And the people didn't listen. And it was as in the days of Noah, as they declared, the new covenant is here, the old covenant is about to die and be completely destroyed and removed. And they didn't hear it. I don't know if you've ever seen it, but if you look at why Stephen was stoned to death, he was stoned to death because of this message. This message could still get me stoned to death in some churches. In Acts chapter 6, verse 13, they produced false witnesses who testified. Now, this is the first thing you have to understand. A false witness doesn't mean that they're lying. It means that they've been paid off. That's what that was in the culture. A false witness was someone they paid. Because it would be hard to get someone to testify at that time against this group of people just for free, because what are they doing? They're healing people, raising the dead. They're awesome. You have to pay someone to be a witness against them. So in verse 13, they produced false witnesses who testified, "This fellow never stopped speaking against this holy place, Jerusalem, and against the law. For we have heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth will destroy this place and change the customs Moses handed down to us." That's the message that Stephen preached that got him stoned to death. This is a message that we have to understand if we're going to establish the kingdom. And we're going to build, and we're going to think long term, and we're going to advance things, and we're going to move forward. Is that we are here as ambassadors and citizens and kings to bring heaven to earth, and not just temporarily until God goes, never mind, let's give it to Satan. That's not his plan. That's not God's plan. We keep bringing heaven to earth, and we establish something here. The apostolos, which is the word that was used to turn into apostle, was actually the name of a boat that would be sent out. After they had conquered a foreign land, a king would send a boat called the apostolos, which carried all the customs and the culture of the kingdom that had dominated. The apostolos, its goal and its mission was to bring the culture of Rome or Greece to that new nation and establish it there, with the ultimate goal in mind that the king who had won and dominated could come and then step out of his boat onto the land and go, "This place feels like home."
Oh, wow. Wow.
That's the goal of the apostolic mission. That's the goal of the apostolos, and that's the goal of the apostles, and that's the apostolic commission that we are to run with. That when heaven comes down to earth, and a new heaven and a new earth join at the end of the book, you can step out and go, "Good job, guys. This feels like home."
Stuff.
I wondered, Northern California, you guys can handle this. I think it's okay. Southern California, not so much. Not ready for it. Why don't you stand? I want to pray over you. Place a hand on your head. Lord, I thank you for the seeds that have been planted. I thank you for what you've released into them, the kingdom thinking, the kingdom advancement. And Lord, I ask that none of it would fall on hard ground, but that it would begin to grow and produce fruit and be reaped. Lord, help your people as they make transitions in their thinking, as they remove things from their language that are misleading and misunderstanding of your whole dynamic of your word. Lord, I know that I've raised more questions than I've answered, and we've established that a whole new foundation of new covenant, New Testament, Old Testament. Lord, that these things, as they go through and they sort out, what is the old covenant dying off, and what is the new covenant in the New Testament, that they would see clearly your kingdom everywhere they look, and not be caught up in the remnants of your old covenant throughout the Old Testament as it was fading away. But they could dust that off and move forward now that your kingdom is here and established and growing. Lord, that we could think long term, that we could think as builders, we could think as establishers, put a firm foundation back under your people.
Yeah.
For us to move this whole thing forward.
Yeah.
I thank you for your people. I thank you for their open hearts, their open minds, their willingness to grow and even be stretched. In Jesus' name, I bless your people. Amen.